like everybody has had a chance to join us. That is fantastic. Hopefully you are seeing my screen. We're going to get started. Thank you so much for joining us for the University of Western States CMHC admissions webinar. My name is Georgia and I'm Associate Director of Admissions. And today's webinar will be an overview of UWS's Master of Science in Clinical Mental Health Counseling. We have a lot of information in the following slides, so we always encourage you, if you have any questions, if we can help follow up with anything, reach out to our front office. We would love to engage with you. We would love to take any of those questions that you have. You can also visit our website, which has quite a bit of information. To do that, head to uws.edu and then head to the admissions tab. And then if you might be looking at multiple degree programs, I know a few people are. We likely have done a webinar before that might cover that topic as well. So you can find those under Connect with Admissions virtually. Again, that's at uws.edu, or you can head to our YouTube page and we will be there as well. So before we get started today, I want to go over some light housekeeping. So today's webinar is hoping to get you in and out in about 30 minutes. It's not a ton of time, but I think we'll be able to do it. If you've got questions for us, though, there is a special box that you might be seeing at the bottom of your page. That's our Q&A feature. Hopefully you're seeing it there, but that is going to be an important resource for us. We'll have an opportunity to get a few of those questions answered in the middle of this webinar. So please feel free to use that if you have a few questions about that program. If we for some reason do not have the ability to answer them in this webinar, if they might take a little bit more research, we'll follow up with you via email, but also everybody who registered today will be getting a phone call tomorrow, hopefully to connect with you, but to at least check in and see if there might be any other information that we could get to you or to answer any other questions that you might have. So be on the lookout for that. But like I mentioned previously, we are always available via email. We love helping to answer those questions. All right. Head back. So here's our schedule for today's webinar. Like I mentioned, we're going to cover a variety of topics. We got a lot to go over, but I'll explore the history of UWS and introduce you to our program director who leads our CMHC program. And then afterwards, we are going to spend a little bit of time discussing our standardized patient program and our online education structure. And then I'll highlight the licensure and certification options for students, as well as give an overview. We'll give an overview of the courses and the field work that makes up our curriculum. In there is a little Q&A. We got a special guest today, so you'll get a chance to chat with a few of us today. But then finally, after that, we'll introduce you to our entry requirements, talk a little bit about financial aid, and then provide those next steps for getting in touch with us and possibly submitting an application to UWS. All right, University of Western States got its start in 1904. So we were originally a chiropractic college. It became the second oldest one in the world. And then in 1986, we received our regional accreditation from the Northwest Commission on Colleges and Universities at NWCCU. In 2018, we launched this program, but a few other ones got launched in 2010 when we began expanding the programs that we offered. Like I mentioned, 2018 was the launch of this program, and then the Clinical Mental Health Counseling program has become one of our most exciting programs since then. You can see our other ones either on this page or head to uws.edu, but this has really been an amazing cutting-edge program that is just bringing the very best, so we look forward to telling you about it today. We'll start out by telling you about Dr. Michelle Rose. She's our program director for the CMHC program. Whereas this program started as a concentration in the sport and performance psychology program that we also have, Dr. Rose's history designing and developing counseling programs helped her create our unique and competitive standalone program that we have now at UWS. And Dr. Rose has her PhD in human development and family sciences from Oregon State University. She is a licensed professional counselor in Oregon, a nationally certified counselor, and a nationally approved clinical supervisor. But let me talk about somebody else as well. I want to make sure to mention Dr. Amy Ohana, who will be another familiar face to anybody who is in our program. So she has a counseling PhD from Oregon State. She is a published author, an expert in several topics, and then regularly teaches in our program as well. And she holds professional counseling license in Oregon. She's a nationally certified counselor and, again, an approved clinical supervisor. So we have a few places that you're going to see the clinical mental health counseling coursework. We have two degrees that include those courses. We have our master's and then our educational doctorate, and they both prepare people for counseling licensure. Our educational doctorate in sport and performance psychology specialization in CMHC prepares a student for counseling licensure as well as certification as a certified mental performance consultant. And that is through the Association for Applied Sports Psychology, AASP. If you're looking instead for something that targets mental health, our master's in clinical mental health counseling, that prepares a student for counseling licensure, and it's ideal for a career in mental health treatment. And that is going to be the focus of our time together today. All right, so why choose UWS for your educational experience? Well, we have a focus on holistic wellness, but one of the unique features of this program is our standardized patient component as well. And we'll highlight that further in the next slide, but this is providing a unique personalized learning experience for clinical mental health counseling students. Faculty design specific case studies, and that creates opportunities for students to apply their knowledge in a real-world scenario that is done with specially trained actors. So students have this opportunity to design their own case studies as well, and then they demonstrate conceptualization skills and process understanding. For UWS, we don't have a GRE requirement, and your tuition is also the same whether you are in-state or out-of-state. This is primarily, you know, an online program that you're participating in, so we've got that flexibility that comes along with that as well, but UWS is practice oriented. Our counseling internships get you real world experience in the field. And speaking of that flexibility, our program, like I mentioned, is flexible not only in being online, but also in the timing. You can take up to 5 years to complete this program. Let's talk a little bit more about those mental health trained actors. So like I mentioned, many of them are professional actors with improv skills that they are bringing to the table. They are carefully trained to portray actual counseling clients. This is meant, like I mentioned, to simulate real world interactions. And this use, as you see there, allows for patients to really dive deep into those experiences, get that helpful practice in a safe environment. And they are getting experience on Skillsetter as well. That's another platform that we use. And this is a really unique teaching methodology. We'll probably hear about this in a little bit, but it's really something special. All right, here is just a brief overview of that degree. So like we mentioned, the format is online. We're on the quarter system. So that is going to be 11 weeks of courses and then 2 weeks of break in between each of those terms. And there are 4 terms in a year. As we mentioned, you do have up to 5 years to complete this degree. It's 90 quarter credits because we're on the quarter system, and the cost per credit you can see there as well. For our program structure, as we mentioned, we're on that quarter system, 4 quarters per year, 11 week quarters. The time commitment for these, we like to say that for every 4 credit course, you're looking at approximately 12 hours of work per week. So 3 hours per credit per week to put aside there. And this is a flipped classroom format. So that means the time that you're spending with your professors is spent practicing your skills. It's receiving feedback after reviewing class materials at home. This really puts the focus on your individual learning and your individual growth in the program. Most students who are enrolled in the program are taking 2 to 3 courses per quarter. And like we were mentioning, you know, if you're taking 2 to 3 quarters, that could be about, or 2 to 3 classes per quarter, that could be about 30 hours a week if you have a more full load. Courses, including discussion boards, all online, as we mentioned, including our wonderful digital library. So students that are completing their practicum and internship are required to connect in person over an online platform. So that's a synchronous time that you would need to connect, but we have multiple times where that could happen. All right, so let's talk a little bit about if you've considered becoming a licensed counselor, what that means. So UWS's program, we're ready to help. Licensed counselors are people who are passionate about mental health and helping treat, diagnose, and assess mental health conditions. We prepare students to take licensure examinations, but we do recommend that you are checking your state's guidelines as well for more information about any additional requirements to meet that licensure standard. Every state does have different requirements, so be sure to check out what exactly is required in your state. We do try to have these conversations early and often as well. Now, I am going to head to our next slide because we are being joined by a very special guest today. So to speak to us more about the curriculum, I want to invite Dr. Rose to join us. Dr. Rose will guide us through the next few slides, but we'll also pause a moment to answer a few questions that you may or may not have. So I've got a few of my own. Hopefully you have a few. Put them in that box below. But Dr. Rose, welcome. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. I don't know how special I am, but I appreciate that word as an introduction. And I want to apologize to our viewers if you can hear banging. I'm in the midst of reconstruction after a water event in our home. We are trying to keep it a little quieter right now, but I apologize if that's impacting you. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for your questions about the curriculum. I'm happy to answer them, but generally, I think what applicants are interested in knowing is whether there's enough rigor in a fully online program to really merit the kinds of responsibilities we have as professionals in terms of assessing, diagnosing, planning treatment, and treating those with mental health issues and behavioral health issues. This is a traditional program in that every core course that would be required by an accrediting body in the field of counseling, we have, and then some. Not only do we have the 8 core courses that would be required by any licensure agency, such as ethics, multiculturalism, psychopathology, human growth and development, all of those core courses, counseling methods, personality and counseling theories, but we've really tried to be unique and thoughtful about what's trending in the field of mental health. So we also have added courses on eating disorder treatment, on case conceptualization, on trauma-informed treatment. We have a marriage, couple, and family course, a play therapy course, lots of content because we listen to our students and our alumni about their interest areas. And because we are in relationship with sites and site supervisors all over the United States, we're getting feedback from them as well about how they want students trained who are going to be working with them in practicum and internship. Those are annual surveys, by the way. So we're taking feedback not just from our students regarding their experience in courses, but their annual experience of our program, our alumni's experience of our program. And I want you to hear that clearly. We stay in relationship with our alumni. They become colleagues of ours in the long term. And then we're assessing their internship site supervisors, and we're assessing their employers. 94% of our graduates are offered positions at their internship sites upon graduation. They don't always take those offers because most have multiple offers or decide to go into private practice. But we think the outcomes for this program are pretty special. Those are some general pieces of information I want to share with you, but really I'm interested in knowing what your questions are and how I can best answer those. Oh, I see somebody, thank you, has asked about the difference between a master's in counseling and a master's in psychology. There are many different mental health professions: psychology, psychiatry, social work, marriage and family therapy, and counseling.
And what is different is the focus of the education. So as an example, and this is overgeneralizing, but as an example, psychologists are taught assessment skills more so than clinical counseling skills. So if you had a family member you thought might have ADHD or might have a mental health issue, you might seek out a psychologist who will do a battery of assessments and write a report that will tell you, hey, here is all the complex ways that your loved one is being impacted by their mental health. Doesn't mean they cannot treat, it just means that their specialty generally is assessment and diagnosis and reporting. Clinical mental health counseling, we are the front line. We are the ones that are actually treating those that are being diagnosed. We are not running out of work, and we're not anywhere close to running out of work because we have seen mental health decline significantly in the world, particularly in the last couple decades, but definitely with the onset of the COVID-19 restrictions. And I think that's the most significant difference. Social workers tend to focus more on what their degree, what their licensure sounds like. They are engaging people with services in the communities. Again, they can do some treatment, but it's really about connecting people to services. And marriage and family therapists, though we have a component of that in our program, really focus on treating whole families, couples, groups, that kind of thing. Doesn't mean individual clinicians, counselors cannot treat couples and families. We do that. In fact, that's what I specialize in. But those are general differences. Georgia, you said you had some questions for me too.
I do. One I was going to ask you is, what are you looking for in a student? I know that there are really incredible students that come to us. Would you speak a little bit to what you're looking for?
Yeah, we work in a very hard and unique profession. Because of the confidentiality requirements in our world, and the very painful subject matter that people talk about, we don't get to share our painful experiences at work when we get home. There has to be, therefore, an underlying passion about serving others, and serving others, particularly in this way, being able and willing to hear their difficult stories without feeling compelled to fix. And that's an interesting thing for a counselor to say. I think the world tends to believe that we are advice givers, but we're really not. Our job is to facilitate a safe space where clients can explore, talk about openly their significant struggles. And then we help them develop the skill sets and the knowledge necessary for them to take the reins, in essence, to help resolve those problems. We have to then, because of that, be able to self-manage a lot and self-reflect a lot. We have to manage our emotions so they don't impact the client. We don't impose our values on clients. So that passion translates in a number of different ways. But it also means that to some degree, we have to be self-possessed, because I cannot randomly share those experiences, the joyous ones or the difficult ones. A lot of what happens for clinical counselors is all right here. It's in the heart, the mind, and the soul. And there has to be some internal sense of strength that aligns with that passion.
What a wonderful answer. Is there anything a student could do or a potential student could do to prepare for either this pathway for them, for their professional career, or for this educational pathway for this degree program?
Yeah, I have a couple of suggestions. One is brand new, a suggestion I'm making for the first time to this audience. But I will say that anybody who's interested in volunteering in their communities, but really any type of volunteering is worthwhile. That puts you in front of a variety of people with a variety of socioeconomic backgrounds and those who might have mental health issues. So crisis centers, warming shelters, school settings. It's a really great way to expose yourself to people you wouldn't typically get involved with and sort of see and understand a broader community of people than we typically reach out to. My unique and new plug is that for those who may like have an undergraduate degree in a completely different field, they're feeling called to counseling, but they're not quite sure it's for them, or they're already functioning as professionals in some other healthcare field. We are just launching this fall a new micro-credential called Mental Health Foundations. It's a series of 3 2-credit courses that for designed for like educators and healthcare professionals to understand how to listen for mental health related issues in their patients and clients or students. The second class is about how to make appropriate referrals and to whom. It answers the very question one of our participants asked today, like, what's the difference between these professionals and how do I reach out to them? And then the third course is communicating in a trauma-informed way about mental health issues with patients and students. So that's another option if you're up for taking a two-credit class before applying or before entering the program. Our Mental Health Foundations courses start this fall.
That is very exciting. Those courses sound fantastic. I can't tell you from my end, or I guess I could, and it's often, how often people who are mental or not mental health professionals, but are other health professionals say to me, gosh, I wish there was just a little bit of mental health, you know, counseling coursework that I could integrate into my work. So I have no doubt they are going to be thrilled about that. I want to make sure that we're not missing any questions. If there are any other questions, I invite you to reach out. In the meantime, I am going to just move through these slides to make sure we didn't forget anything. This is just a little preview at the curriculum of the curriculum. Dr. Rose, is there anything you wanted to make sure to point out about this curriculum?
I think the real key point is that it's comprehensive. Counseling programs are really required by their accreditors to post these types of planners and their curriculum sequence. And I encourage anybody who's looking at a number of different programs to put them side by side to really see the comprehensive nature, but also to see the electives, the unique electives we offer here.
Amen. I will say I'm moving on to those electives because you got to see them. We have people who are so excited about these. I think the electives that we have, not only in this program, but in some other programs, are often the most thrilling part. But the advice that you just gave of printing out, or, you know, digitally, that's fine too. If you got a split screen, wonderful. But if you can print out those course catalogs, those, you know, those curriculum sequences, one of them is going to make your heart beat faster, and you should be headed towards that program. And I don't see how these, you know, courses on here couldn't make you excited to join this program. So these are really just some wonderful, wonderful opportunities to learn from, if I do say so, some of the best. Now, I want to make sure we pause on how do we find a practicum and internship. Would you mind telling us a little bit more about that?
Absolutely. Of course, the longer we are here, so we, like you said, we started in 2018, the more relationships we develop across the United States with various agencies, all types, by the way, inpatient treatment facilities for mental health or addictive disorders. We also have students placed at schools, in private practice agencies, in very large group practices, all across the United States. And our job is to prepare a student for application to sites in their communities. And we do so with assignments in a particular course. So we prepare the students to design a resume that is counseling focused, to know what types of interview questions will be asked and prepare responses to those. And then to how to target the agencies that they're most interested in, that work with the populations they're interested in working with. During that course, we include like a prompt for here's how you'd send an email inquiry, and here's how you reach out. And the majority of our students, especially those that live in larger areas, have really great success with those techniques. For those who live in very rural areas sometimes who struggle, that's my job then to come alongside and start reaching out to agencies on their behalf and with their resume sort of in hand or in electronic format. It seems sometimes that in more rural agencies, my title, the university's presence and reputation seem to make more sense to some agencies. So in those cases, I'm the one reaching out first saying, we have a student in your area interested in working with you. And usually that starts the ball rolling. To date, we have not one student who's had difficulty finding or locating a site. So we're really proud of that. And as I said, we build good, our intention is always to build the best possible reputation with these sites and the communities, the clinicians at that site, so that it's an ongoing opportunity. And we do find ourselves having hubs of students, areas where students are talking about their great successes at the university. And so others of their community are coming to us and applying as well. So we have a lot of people who are at like second and third round students at sites.
That is amazing. What an incredible bridge to have to what this looks like on the outside world, so to speak. I want to make sure that folks see what those requirements look like here. But was there anything you want to make sure to point out about this page before we take any final questions?
I think here is that this is the time period, these five terms, one term of practicum and four terms of internship, in which our students feel most seen and most known. Now, for an online program, the best compliment I ever get is that our students say they're more connected to their peers than they were in their landed programs. We work really diligently to make sure that that happens. But in these courses, you're meeting for 90 minutes with your program faculty to supervise your clinical experience courses. As you just heard me talk about, clinical experiences can be difficult, and the opportunity for us to meet with these students for 90 minutes a week for 55 weeks becomes significant and meaningful. And so just know that if this is a program of interest to you, you're going to be seeing our faces every week by your second or third year.
That is a great point. Dr. Rose, thank you so much for joining us. I do want to just double check that there aren't any final questions, but I just so appreciate your insight, and we really appreciate you joining us today. Thank you so much.
Started to talk and hadn't unmuted. Thank you all for attending. Please feel free to follow up if you have any questions. I'm here
if you need me. And thank you, Georgia.
Of course. Enjoy the rest of your day. We're going to move on to the admission requirements now, but we got the questions out of the way for that. We'll have another chance at the very end of our presentation today where we can talk about any admission questions that you might have as well. So one of the first things that I suggest doing is schedule a phone advising appointment. Really, you're already doing the first thing I suggest doing, which is to join us for something like a webinar and to head to our website. We, after that, though, would love to connect with you via phone. If you're feeling comfortable after that, we can be of help in also submitting an online application. We love to see it before the priority deadline, but if we need to have that by the final deadline, we, of course, are happy to assist with that as well. Something important here I always like to point out is that we do need official transcripts from every single institution attended. If you have done a class at that institution, we will need that transcript. This is required for several reasons, but one of the most important ones will actually be financial aid. If you're applying for financial aid, you'll definitely want to have those in. And then make sure you're completing that entrance essay by fully addressing the prompt. There is a specific prompt in your application, and that essay should be between 250 and 500 words for you. Now, we do require a few other things. If you're ready to apply to UWS, we recommend connecting, but after that, we can help you determine whether or not UWS is the right fit for you and get you placed in either a spring or fall cohort if it is the right choice for you. So submitted applications, as we mentioned, require a few different things. One of those other things that we want to highlight here will be your two formal letters of recommendation. So these are going to be people who are professional recommenders. And something important to highlight here is that one of them must be academic in nature. So if you're thinking, hey, I might want to apply within the next 6 months, this could be a great thing to start thinking about now. We do have a tip sheet for best practices when requesting recommendations, if you might like. We also will have you have a personal interview with our program director. So this is for qualified applicants. An important thing to note here is that one of our one of our important admission requirements is that you are based here in the U.S. We're right now not able to take international students for our program. This is a U.S.-based program. So if you are qualified for an interview with our program director, we'll move you on to there. You'll be able to have a great conversation. And then I hopefully will be able to offer you admission to the program, where we have our final steps after that. So folks who have been admitted to the program are required to deposit. That deposit is $300, and it is applied to the first quarter tuition. So you'll see that $300 credited back. And then you'll also, before starting with us, need to successfully pass a background check. This is something that the university covers the cost of. So something people often have questions about as well will be financial aid. As we mentioned, those transcripts, that's important for financial aid. So that's an important aspect. But we have some other forms that you'll want to submit, namely that FAFSA. That FAFSA form is one that we often recommend you're submitting either while you're completing your application or very shortly after you've submitted your application. That will make sure that we're able to match you with an offer from the folks who are putting that together, both in our financial aid office and at the federal level. That tuition is due on the first day of the quarter, and it's calculated by that credit hour. As we talked about before, we're on the quarter system, and you may have variety in how many credits you're taking each quarter. You may be taking just one class, maybe you're taking two or three, but that will help you figure out what that tuition looks like. Payment plans are available through our business office if anybody is interested in that. They end up being monthly payments, and they have a small fee to process that, but they're able to do that for any term that you might enroll in. And then lots of information is also available about financial aid and financial aid resources online on the financial aid website. They've got a great FAQ. They've got several links on there that are really helpful, both to our internal resources, like their phone number or email address, or some of those steps to submit it, but also to some external ones like the FAFSA and their resources that they provide. Now, if you are applying for federal financial aid, you'll want to be enrolled in at least 5 quarter credits. This is the minimum for somebody who is on the quarter system to qualify. So that would most likely look like 2 classes for most folks. So we need you to remain in good academic standing throughout your time with us. That does look like a 3.0 GPA. And again, this is required for financial aid. So let's talk about a few next steps. I know we have said it many times before about connecting with us, but uws.edu is another great resource. As I mentioned, we do have past webinars that we have on there if you might like to see them. We've also got some other resources from past times that we've sat down with program directors or other short little clips that maybe have come from our alumni. Lots of good stuff there. And if you're planning out when you'd like to apply, that fall cohort is beginning this October. The due date for those applications are by right near the end of July, or not July, August, my apologies, August 27th will be that due date for applications. And then our spring cohort, that will begin in April. So that you have plenty of time for, depending on when you're aiming for. If you're looking at this fall, let's connect soon. All right, we'll pause here to see if there might be any questions that could be of help in answering before we let you go. We are just over that 30-minute mark, so it won't take too long, but wanted to open up the opportunity. And as I mentioned, a few key things there on the page for you, finaid@uws.edu, that's the direct email for the financial aid folks. That number there is their direct line as well. If you have any questions for our admission department, our main line is 800-641-5641. So please do feel free to use that. But we are going to go ahead and say goodbye for now. Thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate you being here today, and we hope to see your application soon. Have a nice day.